Welcome to Coding the Future. We're here at CES 2025. With me today is none other than Mattias Eriksson, president of the QNX division at BlackBerry. Mattias, welcome to the show.
Thank you, Matt. Glad to be here.
Excellent. So the QNX division at BlackBerry, I want to start there. We're here in the booth. I'm seeing a lot of coral. It's very different this year. I saw a couple of people have done double takes because they're expecting the BlackBerry blue, and there's been some changes. So why don't we start there? Tell us about the decision to relaunch the QNX brand and some of the rationale behind why now.
Sure. Yeah, we have a slight change this year, as many people have pointed out. You know, we have talked about the brand for quite some time. As many of you are familiar with, you know, QNX has a strong brand in the automotive industry. We obviously have built relationships for a long time. We have stood for, you know, safety, security, and reliability and trust for many, many, many years. That said, if we think back at the last, you know, 3-4 years, we have actually shifted the portfolio and our capabilities quite significantly. We made a very significant investment in our portfolio over the last 3 years, culminating in the last 12, 18 months in literally the biggest product launch year of a decade. And these product launches, they have all that good stuff from before. They're, you know, the safest, securest, most reliable foundational software platform, but we've added many, many components to it. So just to recap for people, at the end of the day, the performance of SDP8 is not an incremental improvement. It's a step change in what we can do with, with edge compute using SDP8. We have really moved the needle on front loading software development and reducing developer friction with a cloud offering. Mm-hmm. Obviously, one of our big announcements is taking that to the next level here. We have moved the needle on providing more input to the open source community, reaching out for non-commercial use and so forth. So the brand means more now than the positioning of QNX is much more than just safety, security, and reliability. It is also the highest performance, the highest performing edge compute software. So, back to your question around why now, that is the reason. The brand needed a refresh. We have expanded the scope of the proposition in how we differentiate, and that the timing is just right.
Yeah, excellent. You mentioned SDP8.
Yeah.
You know, I know it's hard going from the holidays to CES being the first week in January, but it, by the same token, it does provide a good time to sort of reflect back on the year it was. And when you think back to CES 2024, always lots of announcements.
Yeah.
We announced the digital cockpit design win with Stellantis and AWS.
Yeah.
SDP8.0, the general availability of QNX Sound, QNX Everywhere. Provide us with a bit of a where are they now update in terms of how those initiatives have progressed and matured.
Yes. The short answer is we have great progress across the board. So if we start with maybe the most important part, the customers and the partners and so forth. You know, if you just take SDP8, we have, I think the public announcement at this point is 12 plus silicon vendors committed to SDP8.
Yeah,
obviously, absolutely critical for the success of advanced edge compute. It really helps the OEMs to commit because then they can trust the silicon really there. Over 100 design wins in the last 18 months, material design wins, both in automotive and in GEM.
Yep.
Yeah. When we release products, although we have a general availability date, like a few of them last year, it's a platform, so the work never stops, and a lot of work has continued, you know, refining the platform, you know, which is critical for our customers. And maybe a big one for us is that last year, based on all the progress with the portfolio, we had critical customers globally come back to us and basically tell us, great, can you please do more?
Love it.
We'll come back
love
to that talk.
Yeah,
so
of course.
It's been a very, very busy year. Obviously, a lot of hard work from the team, but I couldn't be happier.
That's excellent. That's great. So you mentioned the OEMs asking us to do more. That's what everyone wants to hear. You know, we also made a big announcement around a vehicle software platform with some key partners in TT Tech Auto and Vector. TT Tech just being acquired by NXP, which is very exciting or whatever. Talk about how, you know, that foundational layer of the stack, undifferentiated heavy lifting, the OEMs are more open to giving up the keys, as it were.
Yeah. Well, so I think it's been quite some time in the making of. So if I were to simplistically describe the last 5 years, so, you know, you go back 5 years in time, everybody knew that software was going to be a critical component of value creation and value capture for an OEM, be it an automotive or a robots manufacturer, whatever.
Yeah. Okay.
Software was going to be very important over the future. And there is probably an argument that many OEMs took the pendulum from, you know, someone else provided the software for me, now I'm going to do all of the software myself. So they swung all the way over, they hired a lot of software engineers. It's a an incredibly difficult thing to ramp an efficient software organization. What we've seen in the last, I would say, 12 to 18 months is that leading OEMs, OEMs that actually leaned in very heavily, hired great people, did a lot of fantastic work, have started to question whether that is the right use of this precious software development resource.
Yeah.
So what does it mean in terms of the architecture? It basically means they're saying, look, I'm spending all this effort at maintaining the foundational base layer literally above the QNX instances, and I can't really charge my consumers for it. I can't really differentiate with that. It sort of works or it doesn't work.
Yep.
So why am I doing that? Why
spending the time, spending the money?
Lift my software engineers and make them focus more in the application layer, for example, on features that matters to consumers that I can sell and enhance sort of the experience with. And we have those discussions for the first time now in the last 12 to 18 months. We made a major commitment beginning of last calendar year to start developing that platform.
Yeah.
The announcement with TD Tech and Vector is sort of the first major step in going public with this. And what does it mean? It basically means, together with two other leading software vendors in advanced edge compute, we're going to put together for OEMs that want to. Not everybody will want to, but for the OEMs that want to, we'll put together a bigger platform on top of which they can build and use their software resources. And for us, the big thing is that we've talked about more sockets, more layers, providing components for quite some time. But what this would mean is that QNX, in certain instances, if the customer so desires, we would take integration responsibility for also other
vendors,
components. And that is a major commercial shift. It's a major positioning shift. It's very nice, a little bit of new brand, the new statement we're putting there. So incredibly exciting. Early days. But very, very exciting for us.
That's great. So freeing up some of those critical software resources who are so difficult to acquire, who are expensive to acquire, to focus on the application layer. That's really the new battleground for the OEMs in terms of delivering new features and capabilities to consumers. That's how they're going to differentiate from one another. So I think that makes a ton of sense. Staying with the embedded automotive software developers, I want to spend a moment talking about QNX Everywhere.
Okay.
This new initiative, I mean, this isn't a product announcement, it's not a customer announcement, it's not a partnership announcement, it's a bit of a different sort of giving back to the industry. So why don't you walk us through, for those that are not familiar with Everywhere, what it's all about and, you know, what do you ultimately hope where it goes 5 years from now?
So I would label it a strategic announcement. I agree with you, it's not a product, it's not, you know, a marketing statement. It's a strategic announcement. It's actually a very strategic initiative for us. So if I were to summarize, you know, at the end of the day, we've done really, really well in the segments we have chosen to serve. A constant complaint across the board is that there's not just enough qualified QNX software engineers in the world. So, I mean, I still remember a couple of years ago, we had an analyst call, and the analyst had done a little bit of research himself. He said, oh, okay, so you have, you know, 75 recs, you're hiring 75 engineers. But I look at everybody else in the industry, and there's literally a demand for 2,000 QNX software engineers at capacity. Where are they going to find these engineers?
Yes, of
course. The problem here being that because we're a commercial software vendor, the threshold for someone, say in university or for any other non-commercial use, starting to use QNX, have been pretty high. You have to pay money to get access to the tools and the libraries and all of that. So what the team has done is they developed a strategy where stepwise now, with the announcement here at CES, we are making QNX and the tooling and the support and so forth available for free for non-commercial use. And combined with that, we're also accelerating a long-going initiative that is about contributing more back to open source. We often get pitched as, oh, you're the commercial evil guys that want people to pay for software, and then you have the benevolent open source community that gives software away. And this audience knows that's not true.
Yeah.
All our software stacks are mixed stacks. All of them have open source. We use open source, we contribute to open source, our customers use it, etc. But we are going to accelerate that contribution to the open source community. You take those two combined, you know, providing non-commercial use access to the greatest embedded software platform for advanced edge compute and a larger open source contribution. We hope that stepwise here, this is a multi-year project, stepwise here, we will really extend the base of qualified QNX developers.
Grow that ecosystem.
Yeah, that's very, very important.
Okay, excellent. I just want to take a moment to pivot to the importance of cloud enablement, right? Last year, AWS, design win with Stellantis.
Yeah.
Now, today, or this week, with Microsoft Azure, broadening out our ecosystem offering beyond just AWS, how important that is that to our customers, OEMs, to provide them with options?
Yeah, so starting with, you know, the general cloud topic first. So cloud, if you want to speed up time to market, reduce complexity and cost, work efficiently with advanced software stacks at the edge, everybody knows that you need to start in the cloud.
For sure.
That is how you solve many of the bottlenecks that people are facing today. It's not an easy transition, but you know, everybody knows they need to get there. And we have obviously worked very closely with AWS for many years.
Sure.
As a great partner. We continue to work very, very closely to them. But the reality is, of course, that AWS has other cloud providers that our customers are using. So we have had as we're making progress with our joint work with AWS, we continue to get the question, well, what about Microsoft, et cetera?
So yes.
One of the announcements this week is we now have QNX running in the Azure cloud, and certain customers have multiple clouds. It's obviously very, very much appreciated by them to be able to, you know, have some flexibility.
That's important. That's great. So we just wrapped up year three of the Software Defined Vehicle Innovator Awards with Motor Trend. Great gala event.
Yeah.
Now that we've come to the sort of the culmination of that three-year partnership, I mean, how would you characterize its evolution? Did it deliver what you thought it would? Has any reactions surprised you by the community? What are your thoughts in terms of the overall program?
So first of all, a great thank you to Ed and Alex and the team at Mototrend.
We
are very different companies.
Yes.
Here you have a media company that is focused on consumers, and then you have a system level engineering company focused on, you know, plumbing. These are two
bit of an odd couple.
Very different companies. But it's been a great partnership. Mm-hmm. I hope we will be able to continue this partnership. We're having those discussions as we speak. Yeah, if you bring it back to where it all started, it started, you know, 3.5-4 years ago, and on the topic of how do you get the best and brightest engineers to, when they graduate from, you know, in the US, Stanford, MIT, whatever, with a software degree, how do you get them to choose to work in automotive as opposed to writing advertising algorithms for TikTok and Facebook?
How do you make it sexy?
How do you shine a light on, from our perspective, what is the most interesting software problem in the world? There's nothing more complicated, difficult to solve, exciting, including multiple technologies, than making next generation cars.
For sure.
So the intent of the initiative was to take sort of the very technical discussion that we are having on a daily basis with our customers and shine the light on the software engineers and basically portray the software engineers in automotive as the heroes of a story and a story that's going to play out for many, many years to come.
Yeah.
And that's how we got to this notion of the gala, collateral, celebrating engineers and engineering leaders that have done great things in automotive software engineering. From my perspective, looking back at the 3 years, it has gone above my expectations. We have had great feedback. You can tell when people get that award, it means something.
Yeah, they're excited.
It does mean something.
Yeah,
because these are, you know, the pyramid is not that big. So at the top, these people know of each other.
Yes.
You know,
it's a small community.
Small community of people that have really done stuff.
Right.
And I think we have made a small contribution to, you know, the overall recruiting topic and shining the light on automotive software engineers. I am very pleased. I'm incredibly excited about what we've done, and I'm also excited about what we can continue to do moving forward. Yeah.
I think we've established a great foundation. Hopefully there's many more years to come, right? So one of the other elements part of the partnership was coding the car too.
Yeah.
The documentary exploring, you know, essentially the rise of China or whatnot. Yeah. As someone who spent a fair amount of time within the region, you know, I guess what sort of, you know, what do you think Western OEMs can potentially learn from their Chinese counterparts in terms of the development of software-defined vehicles? And I know it's you could probably spend a full hour talking about that, but
it's a big topic, and there are many, many components to this. I don't want to get into, you know, a political discussion about you know, the conditions for the change and so forth.
Yeah.
If I just think about the incredible progress China has done, just focusing on the software side, not mentioning the EV, battery topic and so forth.
Yeah.
You know, there is a very vibrant, highly hyper-competitive culture, startup culture in the automotive space in China. I mean, there's probably still 45, 50 OEMs.
Yeah.
They're small, they're startups. Mm-hmm. What does a startup do? You know, they work around the clock, 7 days a week, 365 days a year, and they're hungry. And they start with a blank sheet of paper. And it is much easier to start with a blank sheet of paper than for a large OEM to deal with the existing
legacy stuff,
all the things that they need to do. So they have an advantage, and they have a startup culture, competitive pressure. China is ahead. Mm-hmm. There's no doubt about at this point. And what can you learn from that? I think at the end of the day, innovation is the solution to all problems. You need to focus on the future.
Yeah.
You need to, you know, take risks. You know, new architectures, new ways of solving problems. Otherwise, you're not going to get step change. You're going to get incremental change, and that has tremendous value. But when you have a technology shift like we've had in the last, you know, 5 years, there's new technology available. There's new tooling. There's new capabilities that have been created. You're not going to get to the best of that through incremental improvements or what you had. You have to take the risk.
Take the big leaps.
Innovator's dilemma and on those things.
That's great. Great insights, Mattias. You know, you've been in the industry a long time. You know, thinking back, if you could give your younger self a piece of advice as you were starting out, what would it be and why?
I think the basic advice that you typically give is important. If you want to do exciting stuff, you have to work on disruption and innovation. You have to, if it has been done, it's not going to be
not
the big
thing
somewhere in the future.
For
it's
sure.
just the way things work.
Yeah.
I think if I were to give advice to myself, the most important thing is work with people that are innovators and disruptors. You know, you can tag on to someone that has already started and ride that way.
Yeah,
you know, that is, you know, it makes a difference in the long run. You want to do something new.
Yes. Yeah. Wise words. Mattias Eriksson, thank you so much for making the time. Really appreciate it.
Thank you.
Great.
My pleasure.